بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولوطا إذ قال لقومه أتأتون الفاحشة وأنتم تبصرون أئنكم لتأتون الرجال شهوة من دون النساء بل أنتم قوم تجهلون. فما كان جواب قومه إلا أن قالوا أخرجوا آل لوط من قريتكم إنهم أناس يتطهرون. فأنجيناه وأهله إلا امرأته قدرناها من الغابرين وأمطرنا عليهم مطرا فساء مطر المنذرين. قل الحمد لله وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أالله خير أما يشركون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. The subject that I am discussing tonight is somehow unusual, but I am obliged to discuss it and address it because I received many inquiries, many questions about the stand of Islam on same-sex marriage. Usually we don't discuss these topics at the Islamic centers. But the new generation who lives in America and parcel of this culture, they ask. This is something, this debate is going on nowadays. If you read the, let's say, any newspaper, the LA Times, 60-70% of the pages of the LA Times is dedicated to this subject, especially when yesterday the Supreme Court in Washington, they ruled on this type of marriage, or what they call it as a union, and that is legal. They believe it is legal. They believe it is part of the civil rights of the gay community, and they believe that since those gays are equal under the law, then with other Americans, then this is their constitutional rights. And this is what they should do. And in fact, it came, this ruling came yesterday, and it is considered one of the most important landmarks in the civil rights law and civil rights movement in America. And for those of you who follow the news, yesterday it was a day of victory in America. They call it day of victory. Even President Obama referred to yesterday as a day of victory for the gay community because they struggled a lot. They have been marginalized. La ilaha illallah. I feel sorry for them. They've been abused for a long time, and yesterday they got some of their rights back. Although 37 states, they already accepted this type of so-called equality. Only 13 states, mostly the southern states in America, conservative states, they refused to acknowledge this type of marriage. So yesterday gave them the permission for all 50 states to legalize this type of marriage and, you know, equalize the gay community with the rest of the American people. Of course, there are opponents and proponents for this court ruling. If you follow the news, there are some people yesterday who are celebrating, and this colorful flag, rainbow flag, was being waved all over America, and there was fireworks, I noticed, in the evening. I thought this is, you know, introduction to, you know, 4th of July. But someone told me, no, it has nothing to do with 4th of July. This is Because today is a historic day in America. Those people are celebrating. At the same time, there were some civil, political, religious leaders who opposed to this, and they have very strong argument against it. What does we believe? We as Muslims, what does our book say? The Holy Quran. We are Muslims. We are concerned about our Islam. About what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. About what the Holy Quran says about this issue. Many of the youth, they ask me these questions. What do we think about it? How should we treat those people? We have friends. Among our friends, we have those people. And don't be shocked if you know that some of them go to Islamic centers and mosques. Some of them pray. Some of them fast. Some of them go to Hajj. But they have this problem. So how do we deal with this? How do we handle it? What does we say about it? Number one, this type of, some people call it deviation, sexual deviation. Some people call it, you know, this is a lifestyle choice. Some people call it sexual preference, whatever you want to call it. This type of behavior did exist thousands of years ago. And the verse that I started with in Surah An-Naml, chapter 27 in the Quran, beginning with verse 54 onward, 54 until 59. وَلُوطًا إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ. You know the story, many of you know the story. It's the story of the five cities, they call them the plains. It's mentioned in the Torah. And they practice this. وَلُوطًا إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ. I will come to it, inshallah. I will come to it soon. Since he said to his community, أَتَأْتُونَ الْفَاحِشَةَ وَأَنْتُمْ تُبْصِرُونَ. In a broad daylight, you know this is something wrong. You know this is something repugnant. Yet, you commit this. And the Quran name it as fahisha. And fahisha means a shameful act. Any shameful act that human natures reject and repel is called fahisha. Fahisha is one level above sin. There are sins, many violations, many sins. But this is very repugnant. A more repugnant type of sin is called fahisha. And in particular, when it has to do with immoral acts, especially within the institution of family, between the two genders. This is called fahisha. إِنَّكُمْ أَإِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ. Do you show your desire, men, show desire for men, not for women? This is something repugnant. This is something abhorrent. أَإِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الرِّجَالَ شَهْوَةً مِنْ دُونِ النِّسَاءِ. Allah has created women for you, the opposite gender for you. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. Very beautiful. He says to them, you are spiritually ignorant. This is very good description. He did not say you are scientifically ignorant, because part of this community, some of them are the best lawyers in the nation. Do you know that? Some of them are governors. Some of them are lawmakers. Some of them are congress members. Some of them are judges. Some of them are priests. Some of them are CNN anchors. Some of them are professors at universities. So he did not say to them, you know nothing. You are ignorant. You don't read. You don't write. You don't go to school. You don't. No. He didn't say this. He said, إِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. You are morally and spiritually ignorant, morally and spiritually ignorant. This is important. فَمَا كَانَ جَوَابَ قَوْمِهِ Rather than listening to him and respecting him and saying, we are sorry, we have to look, you know, again at this, examine our attitudes, try to change. They, unfortunately, they refused and they made a mockery out of him. إِلَّا أَنْ قَالُوا أَخْرِجُوا آلَ لُوطٍ Drive them out of our city. We don't want this man among us. They had zero tolerance for him. Rather than tolerating him and saying, listen, let's work out on this, let's discuss this, they had an outright rejection for him. أخرجوا, expel him. أخرجوا آل لوط. Him and his family, except his wife, of course, because his wife was sympathizing with them. إِلَّا أَخْرِجُوا آلَ لُوطٍ مِنْ قَرْيَتِكُمْ إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَرُونَ See, this is important. Here, somehow, they acknowledge that they were wrong. Because they said, Lut and his family, they tried to purify us. يَتَطَهَرُونَ And we don't want to be purified. Leave me alone. Leave me alone. This is my sexual orientation. This is my sexual desire. This is my sexual preference. Don't talk to me. I'm not willing even to discuss this with you. I'm a free person. This is exactly what they said. We don't want to be purified. We don't want to be refined. We don't want to be fixed or corrected. Leave these things for yourself, Ya Lut. Go. Go away. Many sociologists and Islamic scholars believe that they were straight in the beginning. God did not create them deviant. Some people say, well, there is something genetically wrong with them, with their DNA. You can't blame them. Poor people, this is the way they were born. No. Islam says Allah does not create someone genetically with a genetic defect. Never. Allah creates people. Maybe physically there is something, physically, mentally, but when it comes to the issue of sexuality and morality, Allah does not create any person deviant. Allah says we create him according to the original fitrah. My pure fitrah, my pure creation. Maybe something physically wrong with him, but that person is morally perfect. We test some people. We put them to test. Sometimes they are born, you know, with some physical defect, disability, at birth, after birth, before birth, whatever. But this is a test. But we do not create someone who is sexually deviant, and we say to him, listen, I created you this way, and I want to take you to Jahannam. I want to punish you. Allah would not do that. He would not do that to anyone. فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا Allah creates people on when it comes to morality. They are pure. However, the society, the culture, the public perception, the pop culture in America and outside America changes and shifts people's opinion and people's attitude on these subjects. It's the pop culture. It's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say that the reason they became the people of Lut, they acted the way they act, because they were bakhil, stingy. And their city, these cities, which is now, it's part of Jordan today, in Jordan. These five cities, or five villages at that time, they were on the main road. The main road were caravans, they traveled on that road. And sometimes they were stopped by to get some food, some rest, some drink, some fuel, some, you know, for their animals. And since they were stingy, unfortunately most of them, they wanted to frighten people. So when people stay the night there in their cities, they will attack them and they try to rape them. Rape men, not women. So they used this as a weapon to frighten people so people would not stop in these rest areas. Imagine if you drive now, going, let's say, north, east, and they tell you in this rest area there is a rapist, there is a murderer. Definitely you are not going to stop there. You're going to skip that. So they started using this in the beginning as fun, you know, as entertainment. They were not very serious about it. But then generations after generations, they learned this bad habit and it became part and parcel of their lifestyle. And they could not stop it later. They could not stop. They started learning it and it became part of their life. This is how it started. This is how this problem started. Now, whether others they want to believe this story or don't, this is a story. But what we believe is that Allah does not create people who are not straight and then He blames them for what they are doing. So number one, this problem is ancient, it's not something new, but it is rejected by all religions. No religion, no divine religion today, no divine book, no divine scripture, whether it's Judaism, Islam, before that, during the time of Ibrahim, or Islam or other religion, or Christianity, who condone or accept this act of homosexuality. Now, what do we think about it? People say, you Muslims are very harsh about it. Yes, Judaism does not accept it, Christianity probably, some of them, the Catholics until now, until today, I don't know what will happen tomorrow. They still do not accept it, they don't recognize it. But you guys, you Muslims, you kill people for this. So what is the answer? The answer is that if someone believes he has this tendency, but he does not showcase this, neither he or she would practice it, then of course there is no punishment for them. There is no punishment. The punishment comes, it is a sin. It could be a sin, because sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you accountable not only for your acts, but your feeling, for your feelings, and for your thoughts too. For your thoughts. If someone has bad thoughts about others, constantly bad thoughts, this is a sin. But however, Allah says this type of sin, as long as you don't practice it outside, there is no punishment. The punishment comes when this act is practiced. Is it practiced? However, we in America, for those who may be outside and they don't have a full picture, we do not promote this punishment. We don't advocate this punishment. We don't say those people have to be punished. This is a religious verdict. This is in countries that they implement the rule of Sharia. We, the Muslims in America, we don't have rule of Sharia. For a simple fact, we are a minority here. We are a minority. This is not an Islamic society. Yes, this place is an Islamic community, but the society at large is not an Islamic society. An Islamic Sharia is not implemented in non-Muslim societies. Islamic Sharia is implemented in not all Muslim societies nowadays, some Muslim societies, not even all Muslim societies. So we don't condone this. We don't condone punishment. We don't advocate punishment. I'm just giving you the opinion of Islam on this. Now, what is our stand on this? We believe that this is a type of disease. I I'm not saying this is a mental illness. Some of them are very smart. Some of those people are very, very smart. They are genius. Some of them are very good, very generous, very kind. Some of them are very kind. Some of them are religious. Some of them are Jews who practice Judaism. Some of them are Christians who practice Christianity. Some of them are Muslims who practice Islam. But they have a problem. This is a problem. It might not be a physical problem. It might not be a mental one, but definitely it is a spiritual problem, which requires attention, which requires ilaj, a solution. It requires a solution. I spoke with some of them in the Muslim community. They shared with me their problems. Some of them are religious. When I say religious, they are practicing Muslims. But they say, I have this problem. I can't even share it with my family. My family asked me to get married. They are after me. Go get married, get married, get. And I can't. I can't do that. But they don't understand. So they come and share with us. We have to understand that. I'm not saying we have to condone or accept what they do. There is a big difference between saying to someone, yes, no, alhamdulillah, keep it. Yeah, you know, stay as you are. No, no, this is wrong. I'm not going to deceive them because I live in America and this is an open society and we have to accept. No, I have to accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and whatever Allah tells me. But we have to try to understand them, not to punish them right away. Not to say, listen, there is no solution for you. The only way is Jahannam. That's not good. That's not the solution. It's just like a patient who goes to a doctor's office, and as soon as the doctor sees him, he says, oh, you're going to die tomorrow. Listen, no solution. You're going to die tomorrow. Prepare yourself for death. This is not a doctor. This is not a doctor. So we have to understand this problem. Some of them, they are under severe, severe pressure and pain, unfortunately. And they try to change themselves. And they seek counseling. But they still, he or she would say, I tried. Pray for me. Pray for me. I tried a lot. I failed so far. We have to give them hope. Hope. Never give up on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't lose your hope. Maybe this is a test. And this is a test. Exactly, it is a test. It's a severe test. Sometimes Allah tests someone with his money, with his income, with his house. And sometimes He tests him with such a severe, severe type of problem. It's very severe. But they should not give up hope. This is what I tell them. I tell them, the same Lord that I believe in, you also believe in Him. So speak to your Lord. And ask for His guidance. Ask for His help. Allah puts you in a very difficult situation to test you. Never lose hope. Try to change. Some of these influences are societal. Even if you read about the history of this act in America, back in the 50s or 60s, this was a taboo. Nobody could even mention that. It was in the 70s, mid-70s, late-70s, when some of them started to declare publicly. Why? Because the society today helps. The society helps these perceptions. Especially when the Supreme Court, the highest judicial authority in America, they condone this and they give the green light for it, then of course you're going to see more and more people are coming out and they say, I was hiding this for 10 years, 20 years. Now, see, everybody's saying this is okay. And they expect us to say okay. Religious leaders, imams, teachers, parents. But we should not say this is okay. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wa salam has a beautiful hadith in this regard. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, لا تستوحشوا في طريق الهدى لقلة من يسلكه. Do not be afraid. Do not be intimidated if you walk in a path and that path is completely empty. You are the only one who is walking in that path. All others are walking in a different path. You are the only one who is in this path. So don't say, maybe I'm wrong. See, look at people. All people are saying, go to that side. I'm the only one on this side. So maybe I'm wrong. If you know you are right, don't be afraid. Don't be intimidated. Always the path of the truth, the people who follow it are less in number than the path of falsehood. So we are not going to agree with this because the superior court or the supreme court or the president was congratulating Fulan yesterday. You know, the president, he picked up the phone. Did you see that clip? I saw it. And he was congratulating that guy who was fighting for these rights for so many years. The guy is a man. He was a man. And then he says, yeah, and unfortunately, I was fighting with my husband. It's very weird to say a man who says, with my husband. And his husband died, of course, died before they were able to legalize their marriage. So the president was congratulating him on his struggle, on his jihad, long jihad, until today he accomplished victory. We disagree with that. However, what I say, we have to be careful when we handle this problem. Because at the end of the day, those people are what? Are human beings. And every single human being has a right to live, to exist. Every single human being has the right for guidance, to correct himself. Every single human being. And we have to understand the dilemma. I'm not saying we sympathize with them and we tell them, stay where you are, good, ahsan, good job, you know. No. It's just exactly like a doctor who knows this is a patient, he has to fix his problem for him. He does not tell him, stay, you are sick. Stay sick, you know, good for you. No. Now, some parents ask me, do we allow our children to speak to those people, to take them as a friend? Many in the young community here, some of you are here tonight, you ask me, are we allowed to take those people as friends? We know many of them at school. We know many of them at work. So what is our stand with them? Do we stay away completely from them? Not talking to them, not socializing with them? Or we take them as friends because some of them are really good people. They have good qualities. Some of them, they sympathize with the Muslim community. Some of them, they sympathize with justice, with the truth. I remember maybe more than 10 years ago, I was speaking at Westminster College in South Lake City, one of the private universities in the nation. It's called Westminster College, South Lake City. 10 years ago, someone asked me in the audience, he said to me, what is Islam's stand on homosexuality? I said, it is unacceptable, rejected. It's a sin. It's a crime. So when we finished, I was leaving. He came to me. He said, Imam, I'm a convert. He's American, white American. He said, I'm a convert, but I'm a gay. So I want you to teach me. I want you to help me. So many of them, they have good faith. They want to be good people, they want to change, they need help. So in this case, where do we stand on the question of friendship with them? Are we allowed to take them as a friend or not. This depends on the situation, case by case. Islam says, if those people do not pose a danger on you, they don't pose a danger on you, they would not change you or change your perception or your orientation. They would not change your family. Then you may speak to them. Maybe you, as a Muslim, as a good Muslim, educated Muslim, you can change them one day. And when you change them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about this change, about saving a human life. He says, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. If you try to save someone's life, you know that person is not doing good. That person is corrupt. When someone is corrupt, people stay away from him. Oh, don't go close to him. Leave him. Allah says, no. Some of you have to be brave. Brave enough to say, I try my best. Maybe I can change it. Because if we stay away from so-called bad, then who's going to change the bad? Who's going to change them? You think Allah will send an angel from paradise? Anbiya, all the Anbiya, they came to the bad people. They did not come to the good people. Including Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He came to the bad. He came to change the bad into good. And this is exactly what we must do. So before we tell them about punishments, don't be harsh with them. Some ulama, some scholar, they never discuss this issue. When you ask them, what do you think about homosexuality? Right away he says, Jahannam. La'natullah. Immediately. This is not good. This is not the right way of tarbiyah and salvaging people. It's not good. If I start cursing this because he's a liar and this because he's a thief and this because he's... One day Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, he went to a brothel. You know, brothel where prostitutes they gather. In a brothel. He was there. So while he was leaving the brothel, some of his disciples, they say, wow, Jesus, you are here in this brothel? He said, yes, what's wrong? A doctor sometimes sits and people come to see him, and sometimes the doctor himself has to go to the patient's house. Those are patients, I'm a doctor. I came to cure them. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? Those are human beings. Even the prostitutes are human beings. And my message is for all. Not only for the good, not only for my disciples. For the bad too. Maybe they're going to change one day. They have a right to live. They have a right for dignity. Right for guidance. If I leave them, if I don't get close to them, who's going to go to them? Who's going to go to them? We should learn this mentality, this approach. That even when we find someone who's bad, we do not boycott that person. We do not marginalize that person. We don't say, don't get close to him. Those of you who have strong faith, those of you who have self-confidence, those of you who are religiously able and competent, you must go to those people and speak to them. Do not completely disconnect with them. Maybe, who knows? Maybe you succeed, maybe you fail. You leave the rest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So before we speak about punishment and those people have to be punished, we have to speak about the cure. We have to speak about the cure. The victorious person is the one who is adventurer. He goes to bad areas, he doesn't go to good areas. I remember a story that I learned from an American lawyer. My father, 20 years ago, established City of Knowledge in Pomona. An American lawyer, a lady, she brought her son, Christian son, to the school. So she said, I want to, sorry, her daughter. She brought her to the city of knowledge, Islamic school. So we had a debate. Should she be admitted to the school, accepted? This is an Islamic school. And this girl is Christian. She does not believe in Islam. So there was a debate. Someone told me, he said, listen, if you want to admit only the good people in this school, only the good people, the purified, the mu'mineen, the maqsumeen, then who's going to teach those who are non-maqsum? Who's going to teach them? This school is a place where you nurture people, where you change people. So you have to have all sorts of people here, so you can change them. And this is Islam exactly. This is the view of Islam regarding a humanity. In the society, we have all sorts of people. We have people who believe in, you know, heterosexual. We have people who are homosexual. We have people who are straight. We have people who are gay. We have people who are deviant. We have people who are... But then, we should cure. Although, at the same time, I reiterate here what I said. We do not condone same-sex marriage. We never ever condone homosexuality. But this is a type of disease that we must deal with it carefully. We must deal with it with compassion, not with wrath. Not with ghadab and wrath. Not with utter rejection. We have to deal with it with compassion. Maybe, inshallah, at your hand, Allah can save the lives and the dignities of so many people, inshallah. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'mineen wal mu'minat wal muslimin wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat tabi' allahumma baynana wa baynahum bil khayrat innaka mujibud da'awat innaka ghafirul khati'at. تقبل منا صلاتنا وصيامنا ودعاءنا في هذا الشهر العظيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا واجعلنا اللهم من أنصاره وأعوانه وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء in particular the شهداء the martyrs of the recent suicide bombings in Kuwait 28 people were killed yesterday Friday in Al-Imam al-Sadiq Mosque in Kuwait I've been to that mosque many times I know many of those who were martyred the شهداء I know them personally 28 of them were killed and over 250 were severely wounded. Some of them are in a very critical condition until this moment. Out of those 28 people who were martyred, 7 of them were transferred to Najaf to be buried in Wadi Salam next to the shrine of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. So the rest were buried in Kuwait. I ask you to join me to recite Surah Al-Fatiha for those martyrs. And all the shuhada of the Muslimin in Iraq, in Syria, in Yemen, in Kuwait, in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia, and other, and Palestine, and all the shuhada ila arwahihim, Surah Al-Fatiha ma'as-salati ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.